All right, good morning, Living Rock Church Pasadena, family and friends, for those who are here and making their way in, and also for all of you watching online on this first Sunday of March 2021. Thank you for joining. And as we begin our time together, we're going to start with a call to worship. So I'd like to ask everyone who is here to stand, if you may. And we're going to have a scripture reading from Psalm 62. It's on the screen, verses 1 and 2 and 5 to 8. So you can turn there in your own Bibles. Or also just listen intently as I read these verses for us. So Psalm 62, 1 and 2, 5 through 8, written by David, inspired by the Holy Spirit. And after I read these verses, I'm going to give all of us a moment of silence to pray. And as we just think about our week, this first week of March that we've completed, and whether it's been good or not good, that we are here to worship. That's fundamental. More important than saying hello to people or whatnot is we're here to worship the Lord. God gathers his people to worship him. That's why we exist. That's why we're doing what we're doing. So however your week has been, we're going to have a moment of silence to prepare our hearts to focus as to why we are here to worship him. And then I'll lead us in a prayer of praise to our Lord. So a prayer of praise is basically what it means, that it's a prayer more than asking God. It's just giving glory and praise to him for who he is and what he's done for us. And so I'll be giving a prayer of praise, and after that our praise team will then lead us in a time of worship through song. So Psalm 62 verses 1 and 2 and then 5 through 8. For God alone my soul waits in silence. From him comes my salvation. He alone is my rock and my salvation, my fortress. I shall not be greatly shaken. For God alone, O my soul, wait in silence, for my hope is from him. He only is my rock and my salvation, my fortress. I shall not be shaken. On God rests my salvation and my glory, my mighty rock, my refuge is God. Trust in him at all times, O people. Pour out your heart before him. God is a refuge for us. Selah. Amen. Let's take this time to pray as we worship the Lord together. Father, we are here to worship you. More than fraternizing, saying hello, catching up, this time right now is worship to you. And so, Lord, as we have read from Psalm 62, we praise you that salvation comes from you alone. We praise you that you alone are our rock, you alone are our fortress, and we praise you that because of you, we don't need to be shaken or afraid, and that our hope is in you, and that you are our refuge. Father, we also praise you that we can always trust in you. We can wait in silence before you, and that we can pour out our hearts before you. Whether we are joyful or sorrowful or somewhere in between. So, Lord, may we give you the glory, the honor, and the praise this morning that you so richly deserve. And no matter how this first week of March has gone, for each of us, help us to lift our eyes and our hearts to you. That we would grow in love for you and for your awesome glory. And Father, we ultimately praise you that this is all possible because of the finished work of Jesus Christ on the cross for all of our sins, past, present, and future. It's in his awesome name that we pray.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. Up, shining in the light of your glory, pour out your power and love as we sing, holy, holy, holy. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see. Oh,
Now we come to the portion of our worship time together where we have a confession of faith. And as we were doing last month, and we're going to continue on this month, we're going to be reciting the I Am statements spoken by our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ in the Gospel of John. And today, we're going to be reciting together John chapter 10, verses 10 through 16, and how Jesus describes himself as the good shepherd over our lives. So let's recite these verses of Holy Scripture together. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I came that they may have life and have it abundantly. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. He who is a hired hand and not a shepherd, who does not own the sheep, sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and flees, and the wolf snatches them and scatters them. He flees because he is a hired hand and cares nothing for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I know my own, and my own know me. Just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. And I have other sheep that are not of this fold. I must bring them also, and they will listen to my voice. So there will be one flock, one shepherd. Amen. You may be seated. Let's pray. Father, as we have recited just now, as a confession before you and to one another and to the world, Christ is the good shepherd, not just a shepherd, but the good shepherd over our lives. And yet, Lord, we also need to come before you to confess and repent for not following Christ as our good shepherd so many times in our lives. So many times we want to follow thieves who come to steal and kill and destroy, and rather than running to Christ, we in our sin, we want to run from Christ, thinking that Christ is a bad shepherd when, no, he's good for us. So Father, forgive us for our hearts that can so easily choose sin over you, even when we know in our minds that you are better and that you are more beautiful than sin. And yet, Lord, we still struggle and chase after things that are ultimately not good for us in this world. Father, we also come before you to confess and repent as a church for presuming upon your grace. Those of us who claim faith in Christ can so easily drift into thinking that your grace leads to whatever type of living, that we can just do whatever we want. And then we don't care, or we forget your standards or your holiness. Father, we're all guilty of that. If we're honest with ourselves this past week. So may we remember today, Lord, that your grace for us came at such tremendous and great cost. Father, we also come before you to repent and confess for elevating our own hearts and minds above your holy word. Father, if we are honest, we, all of us, are guilty of thinking and saying things like I feel or what I think ultimately is right, rather than saying we want to live according to your word, according to scripture. So Lord, help us to repent of the sin of placing our own feelings and thoughts as the final authority rather than the Bible. God, may we repent of screaming out, I feel, that leads to disunity, and instead pursue your word truly and correctly. And yet, Lord, we also come before you to thank you. We thank you that despite our many sins, Christ is our Savior. He is our good shepherd. We thank you that Jesus gave his life for his sheep, and we are the sheep through faith in Christ, and that although our sins are many, your mercy is more, and your grace is greater. Lord, we also thank you for this church family, Living Rock Church. We thank you that we have members who love each other, who serve each other, who pray for one another. We thank you that your hand of mercy and grace has been on this church to preserve this body through the years and decades of existence. We thank you that you give us the privilege to be gospel witnesses in the Pasadena area. Lord, we also thank you for the grace to give our tithes and our offerings this morning. We thank you that we can freely give, because we have richly received from you. And we thank you that the blessings that you have given to us, and even the privilege to give today and this week, this is all possible because of Jesus Christ, the bloody cross and the empty tomb, glorious resurrection, the ascension, and we know the second coming. And to his glorious name, we give. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
You came from heaven's throne, acquainted with our sorrow, to trade the debt we owe, your suffering for our freedom. The Lamb of God in my place. Your blood poured out my sin, erased it, was my death. You died, I am raised to life. Hallelujah, the Lamb of God. My name upon your heart, my shame upon your shoulders, the power of sin undone, the cross for my salvation, the Lamb of God in my place, your blood poured out my sin, erased it, was my death to die, I am raised to life, hallelujah, the Lamb of God. There is no greater love, there is no greater love, the Savior lifted up, there is no greater love, there is no greater love, there is no
You have bore our shame and our misery on the cross. Thank you, Lord, that we have access into your presence, O God. And Lord, we ask and we thank you today that as your word says, it is so good when brothers and sisters dwell together in unity. Lord, we have the Sorry for the technical difficulty. I was wondering what that was. Like, what are those hands doing right there? Thank you, Brother Tubi, for all that you do. Good morning, beloved. How's your soul doing this morning? Got a couple of announcements to make, and I'm just going to ask you guys to, did you guys bring your walking shoes today? Because it's going to be a long, long chapter we're going to read today. But before we go there, just want to make some quick announcements. Next week, we're going to have prayer here at the church, so please come and join us for that. We definitely want to be known as a praying church, right? Jesus said, this house shall be called a house of prayer. Amen. Also, this week, starting March 10th, will be the start of the Two Ways to Live Bible study led by Pastor Young. So if you would be encouraged to join, that would be awesome. And last but not least, which brings me so much joy in my heart to do this, I'm going to ask Sister Cynthia to come forward to receive the certificate of baptism from last week. So praise God. Praise God. Sister.
Oh, thank you.
So praise God. That was from last week. I'm always so encouraged when people get baptized. In fact, a lot of times when I watch baptisms, thank you, brother. In fact, a lot of times when I watch baptisms, I just want to bawl. I just want to cry. Just seeing what God is doing in people's lives, it's so amazing. You know, we go in, we go down the water, we come up, and it's just a symbol of the new life that God gives us in Christ, right? We're dead to sin and alive to God in Christ Jesus, right? Just a beautiful picture. So today, I'm going to talk about biblical theology, okay? The title of my sermon is Don't Miss Out on Him. And we're going to read Acts chapter 7, verses 1 through 53. So I've asked some brothers to assist me because the passage is quite long. I'm going to ask that we stand in the reading of God's word, and I will ask the brothers to come help me read this passage of scripture.
And the high priest said, are these things so? And Stephen said, brothers and fathers, hear me. The glory of God appeared to our father Abraham when he was in Mesopotamia, before he lived in Haran. And he said to him, go out from your land and from your kindred, and go into the land that I will show you. Then he went out from the land of Chaldeans and lived in Haran. After his father died, God removed him from there into this land in which you are now living. Yet he gave him no inheritance in it, and even not even a foot's length, but promised to give to him as a possession and to his offspring after him. Then he had no child, and God spoke to this effect, that his offspring would be sojourners and in a land belonging to others, who would enslave them and afflict them for 400 years. But I will judge a nation that they serve, said God, and after that they shall come out and worship me in this place. And he gave him the covenant of circumcision, and so Abraham became the father of Isaac and circumcised him on the eighth day. And Isaac became the father of Jacob, and Jacob the 12 patriarchs. And the patriarchs, jealous of Joseph, sold him into Egypt, but God was with him and rescued him out all of his afflictions and gave him favor and wisdom before Pharaoh. before Pharaoh, king of Egypt, who made him ruler over Egypt and over all of his household. Now there came a famine throughout all Egypt and Canaan, and great affliction, and our fathers could find no food. But when Jacob heard that there was grain in Egypt, he sent out our fathers and on their first visit. And on the second visit, Joseph made himself known to his brothers, and Joseph's family became known to Pharaoh. And Joseph sent out and summoned Jacob, his father, and all his kindred, 75 persons in all. And Jacob went down into Egypt, and he died, and our fathers. And they were carried back to Shechem and laid in the tomb that Abraham had bought for a sum of silver from the sons of Hamor and Shechem. But as the time of the promise drew near, which God had granted to Abraham, the people increased and multiplied in Egypt until there overrose in Egypt another king who did not know Joseph. He dealt shrewdly with our race and forced our fathers to expose their infants so they would not be kept alive. At this time, Moses was born, and he was beautiful in God's sight. And he was brought up for 3 months in the father's house. And when he was exposed, Pharaoh's daughter adopted him and brought him up as her own son. And Moses was instructed in all the wisdom of the Egyptians, and he was mighty in his words and deeds.
When he was 40 years old, it came into his heart to visit his brothers, the children of Israel. And seeing one of them being wronged, he defended the oppressed man and avenged him by striking down the Egyptian. He supposed that his brothers would understand that God was giving them salvation by his hand, but they did not understand. And on the following day, he appeared to them as they were quarreling and tried to reconcile them, saying, "Men, you are brothers. Why do you wrong each other?" But the man who was wronging his neighbor thrust him aside, saying, "Who made you a ruler and judge over us? Do you want to kill me as you killed the Egyptian yesterday?" At this retort, Moses fled and became an exile in the land of Midian, where he became the father of 2 sons. Now when 40 years had passed, an angel appeared to him in the wilderness of Mount Sinai, in a flame of fire in a bush. When Moses saw it, he was amazed at the sight. And as he drew near to look, there came the voice of the Lord. "I am the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham and of Isaac and of Jacob." And Moses trembled and did not dare to look. Then the Lord said to him, "Take off the sandals from your feet, for the place where you are standing in is holy ground. I have surely seen the affliction of my people who are in Egypt, and have heard their groaning, and I have come down to deliver them. And now come, I will send you to Egypt. This Moses, whom they rejected, saying, 'Who made you a ruler and judge?' This man God sent as both ruler and redeemer by the hand of the angel who appeared to him in the bush. This man led them out, performing wonders and signs in Egypt and at the Red Sea and in the wilderness for 40 years. This is the Moses who said to the Israelites, 'God will raise up for you a prophet like me from your brothers.' This is the one who was in the congregation in the wilderness with the angel who spoke to him at Mount Sinai and with our fathers. He received living oracles to give to us. Our fathers refused to obey him, but thrust him aside. And in their hearts they turned to Egypt, saying to Aaron, 'Make for us gods who will go before us. As for this Moses who led us out from the land of Egypt, we do not know what has become of him.'"
And they made a calf in those days and offered a sacrifice to the idol and were rejoicing in the works of their hands. But God turned away and gave them over to worship the host of heaven, as it is written in the books of prophets, "Did you bring to me slain beasts and sacrifices during the 40 years in the wilderness, O house of Israel? You took up the tent of Moloch and the star of your god Rephan, the image the images that you made to worship, and I will send you into exile beyond Babylon. Our fathers had the tent of witness in the wilderness, just as he who spoke to Moses directed him to make it, according to the pattern that he had seen. Our fathers, in turn, brought it in with Joshua when they dispossessed the nation that God drove out before the fathers. So it was until the days of David, who found favor in the sight of God and asked to find a dwelling place for the God of Jacob. But it was Solomon who built the house for him. Yet the Most High does not dwell in houses made by hands. As the prophet says, "Heaven is my throne, and the earth is my footstool. What kind of house will you build for me, says the Lord? Or what kind of place of my rest? Did not my hands make all of these things? You stiff-necked people, uncircumcised in your hearts and ears, you always resist the Holy Spirit, as your fathers did, so do you. Which of the prophets did your fathers not persecute? And they killed those who announced beforehand the coming of the righteous one, whom you have now betrayed and murdered, you who received the law as delivered by angels and did not keep it."
Thank you, brothers. You may be seated. Now that's a reading from the Word of God. Amen? Amen. Amen. Let's give the brothers a round of applause. That was awesome. So I've titled the message today, Don't Miss Out on Him. Okay, we're going to talk about biblical theology today. We're continuing a series answering this question, what is a healthy church, or what are the marks of a healthy church, right? And Pastor Young faithfully taught last week that one of the first marks of a healthy church is what? Expositional preaching, right? It's when a church is committed to hear the word taught, explained, and applied. That's what expositional preaching is. Because faith comes by hearing, right? Hearing by the word of Christ. It's the word that transforms us, right? We got to get the word in us to be transformed. And in order to do that, we have to dig into the text of Scripture. This is the source of change. This is the source of transformation. Not what the preacher has an opinion about, because at the end of the day, that doesn't matter. My opinion doesn't matter. Pastor Young's opinion doesn't matter. Who cares? God's opinion matters. Amen? And if we care about God's opinion on issues, we have to hear his voice. And as I said earlier, Jesus said, if you're my sheep, you're going to hear my voice. You're going to want to hear my voice and follow me. This is where we hear his voice. This is why we have to be committed to expositional preaching. The next mark we're going to look at today is biblical theology. Now, I'm going to give a warning to you all. We're going to go on the deep end of the theological pool today, okay? We just are. But I believe this mark is so essential to a healthy church, and it actually helps us to learn how to read our Bibles better and to learn how to read the Bibles the way the Bible was meant to be read. It's exciting, okay? It's really exciting. Some people might say, Joel, I don't need theology. I just need Jesus. But I will ask you this question. Which Jesus are you talking about? Who is Jesus? Because to answer that question, you have to do theology. You see, theology is the study of God. Theology is the study of God. If you're a Christian, you love to study about God. When you were dating, how many of you remember that? Some of us have to go back a little bit longer than others, but when you went back to those days and you were dating, that person wasn't your spouse yet, but you were dating this person, didn't you want to know everything about this person? Oh man, I want to know when she was born, where she was born, what is her favorite movie, what are her favorite colors, what does she like to do, what kind of food does she like to eat, right? You would spend all your time trying to get to know this person. Now apply that to God. If you love God, you're going to want to know everything about God, right? I'm going to give you a quote, and I'll break it down, but it says this: theology leads to doxology. The study of God leads to doxology. What is doxology? Anybody know? praise, worship. The more you study about God, it's not meant to give you information in your head. It's meant to transform you and to lead you to worship Him. Right? As we're going to see in the scriptures, you're meant to encounter the God of the Bible. You're meant to experience Him. You're meant to worship Him. When you study about God's holiness and you're not affected, I don't know. I think what Stephen said to his hearers is true of you. Stiff-necked, uncircumcised of heart and ears. You're resisting the Spirit of God. We'll get into that later on. But theology is meant to lead us to Jesus, beloved. So here's my goal today. I'm going to break it down very simply. I'm going to define biblical theology. I'm going to show why it's important. And I'm going to show you an example of how it's done from Scripture. Stephen faithfully does this for us. Now, we're not going to go through every verse because that will take us 10 hours, right? I wish we could do a series on this, but I've been given the task of preaching through all 53 verses. So I'm going to just summarize and just take a step back and show you how beautiful the story of the Bible is. Let's begin with the definition. The first one, and don't be offended, is from a children's storybook Bible, okay? The next slide, if you guys can help me with that. It's from the Jesus Storybook Bible. Hopefully you guys can see this, but this story is deep. How many of you guys have kids, right? Get the Jesus Storybook Bible. This defines what biblical theology is. Let's take a step back and read this. It says that the Bible is most of all a story. It's an adventure story about a young hero who comes from a far country to win back his lost treasure. It's a love story about a brave prince who leaves his palace, his throne, everything to rescue the one he loves. There are lots of stories in the Bible, but all the stories are telling one big story. The story of how God loves his children and comes to rescue them. It takes the whole Bible to tell this story, and at the center of the story, there's a baby. And I want you guys to, if you guys forget everything I just said, remember this part. Every story in the Bible whispers his name. Every story in the Bible whispers his name. He's like the missing piece in a puzzle, the piece that makes all the other pieces fit together, and suddenly you can see a beautiful picture. That's a summary of what biblical theology is. Here's a simple definition from the Bible Project. Next slide. This one's easy, guys. The Bible is one unified story that leads to Jesus. The Bible is one unified story that leads to Jesus. Now, why is this important? Because churches that don't do biblical theology fall into harm. We fall into false teaching or moralism. Before I explain what I mean by that, I'm going to ask you a question. It's 2021. We're 3 months into 2021, right? How's your Bible reading plan going? Some of you said, God, I promise this year I'm going to read Genesis to Revelation, and I'll be faithful to do it. How are you doing in that area? Honestly, let's be honest, right? Some of us probably started with Genesis, the creation of the world. God made us in his image, right? We're image bearers of God, the fall of man. God calls Abraham and creates a people for himself. Then you get into Exodus. We know about Exodus because of the great movies that we watch, right? The plagues upon Egypt. God rescues a people out of slavery from Egypt. This is awesome. And then what happens? We get to Leviticus. A lot of us stop. If you're a Bible nerd like me, that excites me. I'm excited. I love Leviticus. It's probably one of my favorite books. And I'll tell you why. Because once I started to see that every story whispers his name, and you step back and you see that Jesus is the key that unlocks the meaning of the Bible, trust me, Leviticus will be one of your favorite books as well. But not only is the Bible culturally distanced from us, right? It's a Middle Eastern text. We're talking about a people group that is far distanced from American culture. But a lot of us get so focused on the little stories of the Bible that we forget to step back and see the beauty of Jesus. He's the point of the Bible. In fact, that's the point of Stephen's sermon. Don't miss out on Jesus, man. He's the point of the entire Bible. I'm going to give you guys an example of this in our own lives. How many of us have heard this story of David and Goliath? Right? We're familiar with that. Some of us grew up in Sunday school. Some of us maybe didn't. But what has been the constant message of David and Goliath? The Israelites have this enemy called the Philistines. There's a giant, this man-eating, humongous giant that's slaughtering the Israelites, right? And the Israelites are terrified, and King David steps in, and he gets his slings, and he kills the giant, Goliath, right? What has been the message from American evangelicalism? You're the hero. You need to kill the giants in your life. You need to be like David and kill the giants in your life. Let me pop the balloon for a minute and tell you that you're not King David. You're not the hero. You're not even strong enough to kill the giants in your own life. Do you realize that? We can't put that burden upon ourselves. We're not strong enough to kill the giants in our life. We need someone like David. Jesus is the greater David, amen? He comes in and he kills the giant. You see, David is a giant, but there is a giant and an enemy far greater than David, far greater than Goliath. Goliath was just, he's nothing compared to the real enemy of sin and death and Satan. You see, David chopped off Goliath's head. Jesus comes and crushes the head of the serpent. Do you see the difference? It's not just you're the hero of the story. Jesus is the hero of the story. We need a redeemer. We need a rescuer. So when we do biblical theology, we're looking at all the stories of the Bible and we're saying, how does this point forward to Jesus? How does this point forward to Jesus? Right? There's two ways we read the Bible, guys. The Jesus-centered view and the me-centered view. We're not the center of the story. Now, there are examples to follow, yes. There are commands to obey, yes, of course. But the main point is Jesus. And if we miss out on him, we miss out on everything. So I want to actually turn to Jesus himself, because he taught us to read the Bible this way. Let's turn to Luke chapter 24. Luke chapter 24, Jesus himself teaches us how to read the Bible. Okay? Now, in your own time, I'm encouraging you to go read the whole passage, Luke 24, 13 through 35. We're not going to read all those passages, but I'm going to summarize and say this. Jesus has been raised from the dead. He's alive. The women see that his body's not in the tomb. They start spreading these reports that we don't know where his body is, but these angels came and told us he's risen from the dead. There's these two disciples that are walking on the road to Emmaus, right? And they're talking about these things. Man, I can't believe this, man. Can you believe this? What just happened? And they're so discouraged. And Jesus pulls a Clark Kent on these disciples. You guys know Clark Kent, right? Superman disguises himself as what? Clark Kent. They don't even recognize who this guy is. So this guy comes up to them, and it's Jesus disguised. Jesus is in disguise like Clark Kent. And he says, hey, what are you guys talking about? And they say, are you serious? You have not heard what has just happened? This guy that said he was the Messiah, did all these great miracles, and he's dead. We thought he was going to be the one to rescue Israel. And what does Jesus say to them? Jesus actually teaches us how to read the Bible. He says this. He says, oh, foolish ones, slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Wasn't it necessary that the Messiah should suffer these things and enter into his glory? Now watch this. Beginning with Moses, that's Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, and all the prophets, he interpreted to them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself. Like Jesus is saying, I'm the point of the Bible. Moses talked about me. The prophets talked about me. And then in John 5, it gets even more powerful. Next slide. Look at what Jesus says to the religious people of his day. He says, "You search the scriptures because you believe they give you eternal life. But the scriptures point to me. Yet you refuse to come to me so that I can give you this eternal life." Listen to what he's about to say. "But if you believe Moses, you would have believed me because he wrote about me. And since you don't believe what he wrote, how will you believe what I say?" Ouch. That's the Son of God speaking. "I'm the point of the Bible," is what he's saying. Genesis to Revelation. Let's not miss out on Jesus, guys. The point of the scriptures is that we would come to Jesus, that we would taste and see that the Lord is good. But as Stephen will go on to show his hearers, they had the same Bible. The religious people had the same Bible that we have, but they did not come to Jesus. They didn't read the Bible right, and they didn't read it with the right spirit. They didn't read it with the right spirit. So now let's go to Acts 7. I know that was a long introduction, but I felt it was necessary, guys. I felt it was necessary. We're going to turn to Acts. What does Stephen do? He's put on trial. And they ask him, "Are the accusations that they're saying about you true?" What is Stephen accused of? You go back to chapter 6. Stephen is accused of speaking evil against the temple and against the Bible. Okay? He's falsely accused. And what Stephen in his defense does is he actually takes this opportunity to tell the whole story of Israel. I mean, you guys heard it, right? As the brothers faithfully read today, he tells the whole story of Israel. He's going to say, "This is all pointing to Jesus. Don't miss out on Jesus, guys." But notice what Stephen does, and notice what he doesn't do. And when God showed me this, man, I was just blown away. One of the high priests says, "Stephen, are these things true, what they're saying about you? Like his life is on the line. Like he's going to die. He's going to get stoned," right? This is Stephen's opportunity to get out of jail. What would happen if you were asked these things? If you were falsely accused, put in court, like many Christians are today. In fact, there was a pastor recently in Canada. What would you do? Are these accusations true that they're saying about you? Like, notice Stephen doesn't try to preserve his life, right? He's not trying to save his life. It reminds me of the Apostle Paul. Paul said, "I don't count my life as valuable in and of itself." Jesus said this. He went a step further. He said, "If you try to save your life, you're going to lose it. What will it profit you if you gain everything and you lose your soul?" What Stephen is teaching us is he was completely surrendered to God. He was completely surrendered to God. He gave his body as a living sacrifice. He says, "I'm ready to die." And he doesn't even try to defend himself. Really, what he's doing is he's taking this opportunity to share the gospel. That's amazing. That was so encouraging when I saw that. And what he tells his hearers is that, no, I'm not the one speaking evil about the temple. I'm not the one speaking evil about the Torah. You are the ones who blaspheme God. You are the ones who blaspheme God because you rejected a person. You rejected a person. God in the flesh came down and he was here in your midst and you rejected him. So Stephen, one of his main points is he's going to show them how through Israel's history, God raised up rulers and redeemers who God's people rejected and rebelled against. God raised up rulers and redeemers time and time again who Israel rejected and rebelled against. God was paving the way patiently for the one person that would come. Everyone was pointing to him. And I'm going to show you how all these stories point to Jesus today. Okay? So we turn to Acts chapter 7, right? And if you remember, verses 2 through 8, we're not going to read everything all over again, but I'm just going to summarize these main points and show you. First, Stephen tells them, you remember Abraham? God promised Abraham the land of Israel, right? He took a people that were nomads, and he says that God took Abraham and his family, and he gave a promise to Abraham, if you read Genesis 12, that through Abraham, all the nations of the world would be blessed. All the nations of the world will be blessed. But he said to Abraham, there's going to come one of your great, 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 great grandkids, and he's going to bless the world. Why is that? Let's take a step back. Let's do biblical theology. Remember, in Genesis, God creates the heavens and the earth, 6 days, right? Humans made in his image to represent him. But humans, what did they do? We failed. We rebelled against the Creator, right? And because of our rebellion, curse was brought into the world. Curses, the curse of sin, the curse of death, disease. And then God does something amazing in the story. He says, I'm going to take a family. And through that family, I'm going to undo the curse of creation. You see that? Isn't that beautiful? It's going to be through one offspring of Abraham. One offspring of Abraham. So Stephen takes them through that story to show them there's going to be a descendant who's going to undo the curse of creation. We know who that is, right? You see how this story whispers his name? Abraham whispers the name of Jesus. Now we go to Joseph. If you thought Abraham whispered Joseph's name, Joseph is getting louder. Verses 9 through 16, before I even go there, let's look at verse 52 real quick. Chapter 7 and verse 52. Stephen says this, which of the prophets did your fathers not persecute? And they killed those who announced beforehand the coming of the righteous one. Who is that? The righteous meaning innocent. All the prophets, all the people he was just talking about in his speech were announcing the coming of the righteous one. Jesus, right? He explicitly states in this verse that Jesus is the Messiah. He's the promised one. He's the righteous one. But what he gives in his story are shadows. Joseph was a shadow showing the future reality of who Jesus was. Verses 9 through 16, Stephen tells his hearers, do you remember Joseph? You remember Joseph? We're going to look at Joseph. You see, in Jewish tradition, and you know what? I'm glad. I was kind of glad, but I was not kind of glad. When Pastor Young said, do biblical theology, Acts 7, 1 through 53, I said, that's a lot of verses, but I'm glad, and I'll tell you why. Because before my conversion, some of you know, some of you may not know, I was actually in the process of becoming a Jew. Maybe some of you didn't know that. I was studying the Torah. I was learning Hebrew. I knew about Jewish culture and tradition. So when it comes to the Old Testament, I get a little excited. Just a little bit. But in Jewish tradition, there is the line of thinking from the rabbis, and they teach that, well, there would be two messiahs, Messiah ben Yosef and Messiah ben David. What does that mean? They think that there's two messiahs. There's a Messiah, the son of Joseph, and the Messiah, the son of David. The Messiah, the son of David, would be the king, the ruler, just like David, right? He would come from the line of David, like the scriptures say. The Messiah, the son of Joseph, would be the one who would suffer hardship and pain and endure trial just like Joseph did. What we have in Jesus is beautiful, right? He's both. He's Messiah, the son of Joseph, and Messiah, the son of David. He's all in one. One Messiah. Let's look at these similarities and let your mind just be blown away. Between Jesus and Joseph, both are from the nation of Israel. That's I know. That's obvious, right? They're both Jewish people. They're both Israelites. But it starts getting deep. Joseph was sold into slavery by his brothers because they were jealous of him. Jesus was sold and delivered up by his own people because they were jealous of him. Do you see that? Joseph was sold for a price. Jesus was sold for a price. Betrayed by his own people, his own brothers, according to the flesh. Joseph was imprisoned because of false accusations by Potiphar's wife. Remember that? He's in a room, Potiphar and him, right? Potiphar's like, hey, let's do this thing. And Joseph says, I can't sin against God. I'm going to run. And man, that's for us. We got to run from sin. We can't play games with sin. That's not my point today. Joseph was in prison because of these false accusations. So she says, hey, he tried to rape me. And then he's put into prison. Now Jesus was condemned to death because of false witnesses. Same thing happened to Jesus. Check this out. God freed Joseph from prison and exalted him to a high office. Joseph became the what? The king, basically like a king of Egypt, right? God freed Jesus from the prison of death and exalted him to be king, not just of Egypt, but of the entire world. As Ephesians and Colossians say, the entire universe. Every molecule is subject to his lordship. He is king. This is crazy. Joseph delivered his brothers from physical famine and physical death. You guys remember the story of Joseph? His brothers were experiencing a famine. They had no bread, no food, nothing to eat. And what was said by Jacob? He said, you want bread? Go to Joseph. He has bread. How can you not see that this points to Jesus, man? He's the bread of life. You want bread? Jesus is the bread of life. Jesus said, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never hunger again. How many of us can say that we've tasted of the bread of life, of Jesus? You try to go back to that sin, it doesn't taste the same, right? Sin doesn't taste the same once you've tasted Jesus. Amen? So hopefully you can start to see the story of Joseph whispers his name. Joseph, you know, if Joseph could talk, he's saying, don't look at me, I'm just a shadow. Look to the one who's coming later. He's greater than I am. The greater Joseph is coming. Now we're going to turn to Moses, verses 17 through 40. And if you thought Joseph was getting a little louder, Moses is starting to shout his name. We just watched the Prince of Egypt. Have you guys seen the Prince of Egypt? That is an awesome movie. Watch it whenever you have a chance. Stephen now turns the tables around. He says, the ancestors, your ancestors rejected Moses, but they also reject the one Moses prophesied about. Now we're going to look at Moses. Tell me this doesn't shout Jesus. Remember when Moses was born? What did Pharaoh do because he felt his kingship was threatened? He said, let all the Hebrew boys be killed. Before Jesus was born, remember we celebrate this at Christmas time, Herod gets a little inkling, a little news that there might be a Messiah, there might be a king coming up. He feels his kingship is threatened. What does he do? Let the Hebrew boys in Bethlehem be what? Slaughtered. Jesus and Moses, before they were even born, or went at their birth, their lives were on the line, threatened. That's crazy, right? Even in this passage, if you read, it says that Moses was mighty in word and deeds. That same language is used about Jesus. Who else could do miracles like Jesus, right? Powerful. Now look at this. Moses was in the wilderness for how many years? 40 years. And guess what? With Moses, he failed the test. He wasn't even allowed to step foot into the promised land. Jesus was in the wilderness for 40 days. Did he pass the test? Yes, he did. Because if Jesus didn't pass the test, we wouldn't be here today. Amen? This is crazy. Moses humbled himself by leaving Pharaoh's palace, right? I mean, Moses had it good. He was in Egypt. If you read Stephen's speech, it says he was studying all the wisdom of the Egyptians in the palace, adopted by Pharaoh's daughter, as they say. He had things great, but he left that palace. He humbled himself. In fact, Moses is called one of the most meek and humble men of all the earth, right? In the book of Numbers. You think Moses is humble? Jesus is God, and he left his throne, condescended, and became flesh. Wow. Moses was rejected at first by his own people, right? There was a fight breaking out. One Hebrew was fighting another. He says, what are you guys doing? They reject him. What does John 1, 10 and 11 say? He came to his own, and his own received him not. Rejected by his own people. Moses was a shepherd, right? Jesus is the good shepherd. Moses redeemed his people from bondage in Egypt. Jesus redeems us from bondage to sin and death. But here's the thing. Moses wasn't just a type and a shadow. He actually prophesied directly about the coming of the Messiah. Look at this, Deuteronomy 18:15. Next slide. This is what Moses said. He's not just saying, I'm a shadow. He's saying, listen, the Lord your God will raise up for you a prophet like me from among you, from your brothers. Moses says three things about this future prophet that we need to know. See, Moses wasn't just a shadow. All those shadows, it's amazing when you see. You step back, you're like, wow, that's amazing. But Moses is saying, look, there's a prophet that's coming. And I want you to know three things about him. One, he would be an Israelite, right? He says, from among you, from your brothers. This means Jesus was not a first century, blonde hair, blue-eyed European. So if they make another Jesus movie with a blonde hair, blue-eyed European, I will be furious. We need to stop this madness. Jesus was an Israelite, right? Number two, he would be a prophet like Moses. Look at what Moses said. He says, a prophet like me. What was Moses known for in the Bible? Numbers says that there was no prophet as humble as Moses. The Jews regard Moses as the greatest of all the prophets. But more than that, God said, with all the other prophets, I speak in visions. With Moses, I speak face to face. With Jesus, he had a face-to-face relationship with his Father. And he was more humble than Moses could ever even think of. Are you starting to get this picture now? And this is the most spectacular. When I saw this, and some of the early church fathers saw this, it says, the Lord your God will, you see that word? Raise up for you a prophet like me. Literally, raise. Do you see that? The prophet I'm speaking about will be raised from the dead. That was just an interesting observation. The story of Moses whispers the name of Jesus. Now we turn lastly to the tabernacle and the temple. Hopefully you're seeing the promise to Abraham whispers his name. Joseph is whispering his name. Moses whispers his name. And now the tabernacle and the temple. You see, the Jews had the tabernacle and the temple. But what happened even though they had the tabernacle and the temple? What was the tabernacle a symbol of? God's presence, right? God's present with his people. But what happened, as Dan Paul read? They fell into what? Idolatry. They fell into idolatry despite the very presence of God being among them. Now you see how Stephen quotes, and we're going to look at verses 44 through 50. He quotes from Isaiah 66. He says, you think God is simply limited to a building? Like God says, heaven is my throne, the earth is my footstool. You think this is enough for me? Don't limit God's presence to a building, right? Even Solomon said this. Next slide. When Solomon built the temple, he said this. He acknowledged this. Will God indeed dwell on the earth? Behold, heaven and the highest heaven cannot contain you. How much less this house that I have built? Even Solomon acknowledged you can't limit God's presence to a building. And you know, we do that too. We're guilty of that. You hear the comments, hey, don't bring coffee into God's house. Don't bring drinks into God's house. As if God's house refers to this building. But the scriptures emphatically declare that God is near. He is present to those who call on him, to those who are broken, those who are broken in spirit, right? And here's an amazing thing. When you put your trust in Jesus, you don't look to go to a temple. Guess what happens? You become the temple of the living God when the Holy Spirit dwells in you. You are now the temple of the living God. More than that, and this is how it points to Jesus. Look at John 1:14. Next slide. The Word, that's Jesus, became flesh and dwelt. And in the original language, it literally means tabernacled among us. Like the Old Testament tabernacle, God pitched his tent and lived with his people. When Jesus came down, he pitched his tent and lived among us in our filth, in our dirt, in our shame. He lived among us. Isn't that amazing? But they missed the point. They missed the point. You see, Jesus rebuked, as I read earlier, he rebuked the religious leaders, right? Why? He said, you think you can read these scriptures and they'll give you eternal life. He says, no, they're meant to point to me. Come to me and I'll give you life. But you're refusing to come to me. And Stephen starts to turn it on its head in verses 51. And 52, he says, you stiff-necked people, uncircumcised in heart and ears, you always resist the Holy Spirit. And as I meditated on that, I thought, you know, there might be some people even here today who are listening to this, who are right now resisting God, who are right now resisting the Holy Spirit. And how do you know you resist the Holy Spirit? Because Jesus is not your king. Something else is. If Jesus is not your king, something else is. Maybe you're your own king. Maybe something else that you love is a king. And you follow that. You worship that. And what God is saying is, don't resist me. Stop resisting me. Come to me and I'll give you life. If you would only taste and see that the Lord is good, man, I'm telling you. He is good. And once you partake of him, once you believe and trust in him, you won't want to go back. But Stephen rebukes these people because they miss the point. They didn't read the Bible right. And they didn't read it in the right spirit. Why? Because they were uncircumcised in heart. When the scriptures speak about the heart being uncircumcised, it means you're dead. It means you need a new heart. It means you need the Holy Spirit to operate on you. You need a heart operation. You need God to give you a new heart. And that heart is a heart that loves God, a heart that wants to see that Jesus is the point of the Bible. We need to read the Bible right, beloved. So here's some practical advice. How do you see and read your Bibles? I want people to be excited when they read their Bibles, especially the Old Testament, because we're so distanced from the Old Testament. Here's one recommendation. How many of you like a good story? Chronicles of Narnia, The Lord of the Rings, whatnot. It's a good story, right? The Bible's actually a story. But we don't read it like it's a story. I would recommend you to get a reader's Bible. I actually brought my reader's Bible. I use this for my daily reading plan. What they've done is they've eliminated chapters, verses, footnotes, cross-references, and all you see is just a story. You know what happens when I started this thing? You get lost. You get immersed in the story. I'm only supposed to read 2 chapters today, but I ended up reading 10. Don't tell me how I did it. I just got lost in the story. I forgot that I was supposed to only read 2. Because all that other stuff is gone. You just keep reading along. And you're going to see how beautiful the progression of the story is. So my recommendation, get a reader's Bible. Get immersed in the story. But more than getting immersed into the story, don't just get immersed, interact. The story should lead you to Him. Fall on your knees. Actually, I would suggest reading your Bible and praying at the same time. Prayerfully reading your Bible. Because it's meant to lead you to worship. It's meant to lead you to worship, right? So a couple of things to remember. We're not the hero of the story. It's not about you. It's about Jesus. We need a hero. We need a rescuer. And fall in love with the story of Scripture. Get lost in it. Get into the Word so the Word can get into you. Get into the Word so the Word can get into you. And if you forget everything else, don't miss out on Him. If you haven't bowed the knee to King Jesus, Jesus gives the invitation. He says, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never hunger. If you have not repented and believed in Him, I'm pleading with you today to do that. Because the Holy Spirit is here right now. And His desire is that all men should repent and believe in Him. Amen? I saw a video this morning. I wish I didn't see it. It really just kind of damaged my mind. But there was an incident in Bolivia not too long ago. I don't know what was the commotion, but there was all these people on the 4th floor of a building, and the metal railing that was holding them all up fell, and 7 people fell to their deaths, and it was all caught on video. I was just scrolling through the news. I didn't mean to see that, but I ended up seeing it, and I wish I didn't, but I kind of am grateful I did, because we don't know what's going to happen. I hope we understand that with this pandemic, we see the frailty of our lives, right? We're frail. We're here today and gone tomorrow, as the Bible says. We're like a vapor in a mist. And that's why Stephen says, don't resist the Holy Spirit. He's here right now. He's urging you to repent. Would you pray with me? Father, we thank You for Your word. Father, we thank You that You invite us to come into Your presence because You're gracious, You're patient, and You're good. God, if we would only just see how good you are and know that, Lord, when we are repentant, you are like the father who runs after the prodigal son and who embraces him and kisses him and gives him the best robes. God, you're a good father. You are more willing, more than willing, to embrace us, Lord. Pray that everyone here would know your love and be and just captivated by your love today. God, I thank you so much. I pray you bless our week, that we would go out, Lord, and be good storytellers. Storytellers of the best news, the greatest news of all, the greatest story ever told. And we would get excited when we read your word so that we can see how it all points to Christ. May we be excited as we read your word this week and share it with others. Thank you, Lord. We love you so much, Lord, because you loved us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you for the word, brother. And as today is the first Sunday of the month, we're going to celebrate the Lord's Supper together. And before we celebrate together, I'd like to ask if you haven't received the elements, if maybe Brother Joel and Brother Sarli wouldn't mind maybe passing out the elements to those who have not had one, gotten the elements yet. And as they pass them out, if you do require one, please just slowly raise your hand. But why is Lord's Supper important? Well, last Sunday, as we had mentioned, we celebrated baptism. And according to Scripture, so we're not making this up because of how we feel or think, according to God's Word, we celebrate baptism and the Lord's Supper. These are visible illustrations of the gospel, of the storyline of Scripture, as Brother Joel just preached. And so when we preach and we hear the Word being preached, we are using our ears and our mouths. When we celebrate baptism and the supper, we are using our hands and our eyes to behold the glory of the Lord and what he's done for us. For all of us here and watching online who have proclaimed genuine faith in Christ. So when we celebrate baptism, as we did last Sunday with Sister Cynthia, as we're going to celebrate the supper today, we don't do this to make ourselves feel better or think that we're better or greater than anybody else. We do this with humble expectation before the Lord, that who are we to approach him? That he came down for us. That's what Christ did. We get to celebrate that and give him glory, which should stir in our hearts joy. And if there is no joy stirred up on some level, then a deeper question has to be asked. Do you believe? Right. So this is a reminder for those of us who are believers as to what this is about. And it's also a witness to any maybe here or watching online who do not believe today. And as Joel just said, repent and believe in Christ. So I'm going to actually read, and you can turn there if you'd like, 1 Corinthians chapter 11. I'm going to start in verse 23. And this is what the Holy Spirit inspired the Apostle Paul to write these words. 1 Corinthians 11, 23, for I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus on the night when he was betrayed took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way also he took the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. So the supper proclaims the gospel visibly. And it proclaims the past in remembrance of the past, what Jesus has done, and even as he instituted the supper with the original disciples, the apostles, It also is a reminder today of what we have in Christ. And the beautiful thing of the supper is it proclaims a future when Christ comes back and we will have the greatest of meals with him face to face, so that what we believe in faith right now, we will see with our own two eyes. That's going to be a beautiful thing. So whatever food you think is the best right now, the best meal is coming in the future. That's what we're celebrating today. But the Apostle Paul continues on in verse 27 in 1 Corinthians 11. Whoever therefore eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty concerning the body and blood of the Lord. Let a person examine himself then, and so eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without discerning the body eats and drinks judgment on himself. What is he saying? So as we approach the Lord and we celebrate the supper, okay, yes, this is just juice and a little wafer. There's no magical power like Popeye's spinach in this. But there's a reality as we approach the Lord that we don't do so in a cavalier attitude. So for those of us who do believe, this is an opportunity for us to come before the Lord, confess, and repent. And just lay before him our sins, because we're all sinners in need of grace. And if I have something against another person, I have sinned against another, to repent, confess, and then pray before the Lord. Maybe I need to go approach that sister and brother and ask for their forgiveness. And maybe if I've been sinned against, to offer forgiveness because he has given forgiveness to me. That's what this is about for those of us who believe. So here's kind of some instruction. If you are a believer in Christ, baptized and in good standing with your local church, so which means for this church, if you're a member, and then if you're visiting from another church, we welcome you as well. Please take this and we'll celebrate together. But if you're not a believer in Jesus Christ, if you're kind of, I don't know if I really believe, then we would just respectfully ask for you to refrain from celebrating and taking these elements. And we do not ask you to do this to shame you. And if anyone shames you, please let me know, because that's sin if we do that to you. No, we do this to celebrate. And really then, if you don't believe, this juice and this wafer really means nothing to you. So we ask that you would just refrain that. So Brother Joel and Brother Starley, just to pass out the elements to those who haven't received it yet. And I'll give us a few moments. And then once you receive the elements, just spend some time in meditation and prayer. And then I'll give us further instructions. Okay, let's first take out the wafer and hold it up visibly to one another. So if you don't mind holding up the wafer in front of you, then that can visibly show me that we're all ready to go to take it together. So this wafer represents the body of Christ that was broken for us, those of us who believe on the cross. And he said, "This is my body, taken." Now let's prepare the cup and hold it for all to see. So this cup represents the new covenant. The promise that was foretold in Scripture to us, to all those who believe, those before us, those now, and those who will come after us, that Christ on the cross shed his blood to pay for all of our sins, our past, our present, future sins, and through faith in him to give us forgiveness and eternal life that is full and free forever. So he said, "Drink this in remembrance of me." Let's pray together. Father, we thank you and praise you to give us this opportunity to give you worship through the celebration of the bread and the cup, representing the body and the blood of Christ. In Christ alone, all of our hopes and joys and pleasures are found, that we can taste and see that you are good because of Jesus Christ. So, Father, may it be that today, what we have just done right now, was not just some religious exercise or ritual that we have done, but it was a remembrance and a celebration and an act of worship and offering before you. That you have given us so much in Christ. We can have the privilege and the joy to come before you and to celebrate this supper. Father, as was echoed and said before by Brother Joel, today, sooner rather than later, may it be that anyone here or watching who does not know Christ and has not experienced salvation in his name would call upon his name and be saved. And for those of us who believe that we would be quick and eager and ready to share the hope of the world, Christ Jesus, who died for sinners. And we're all sinners. So, Father, again, we thank you and praise you for this opportunity to celebrate today. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
You give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness. You give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. You give life. You risk. And all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. And all the earth will shout your praise.
Thank you for joining us in this first Sunday of March 2021, worship before the Lord, Living Rock Church Pasadena, here in person, and also to all of you watching online. So I'm going to give a closing prayer for us, and then a final scripture reading from Revelation verses 5 and 6. And if you don't mind, with the communion cup, if you don't mind taking that with you and disposing that in a trash waste basket, that would be much appreciated by our church leadership. So let's pray together. Father, as we have sung, great are you, Lord, that it is your breath that is in our lungs. We didn't create the air. We didn't create the oxygen. You did. You even created our lungs so that we could breathe, and by breathing every single breath, give you glory as creator, sovereign, ruler, Lord of the entire cosmos and the universe. And yet at the same time, making each single one of us in your image and likeness from the very beginning of conception in our mother's womb. Father, what an amazing, glorious thing that you have done for yourself and for us. And Lord, as we go forward this week, help us to be your hands and feet, the hands and feet of Christ, to display the gospel, share the true story of the gospel, the big story of the Bible, not only with little kids, not only with ourselves, but others who do not know you today, so that they would see the story, receive and believe Christ today. Hear this reading from Revelation 1, from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn of the dead, and the ruler of kings on earth. To him who loves us and has freed us from our sins by his blood and made us a kingdom, priests to his God and Father, to him be glory and dominion forever and ever. And every believer says, amen. Amen. Well, thank you for joining. Have a blessed and wonderful week in Christ. See you next Sunday. Thank you.
Thank you.